If anybody's outside, you may want to find your seats inside. Before we start the proceedings, here are some necessary housekeeping. When you get caught short because you have bladder issues, or the speeches are too long or boring or sad, the wharepaku or the toilet is downstairs. You have to go out of the building, through the car park, and downstairs where you probably saw the food has been laid out. There are four exits, two in the front, two in the back, fire exits, and there are fire wardens that will be on hand to direct you in the event of a fire. And the assembly is outside, not at the K Road Family Bar, as some of you might think. Smokers, just give up. Please don't feel as if you have to rush off at the end. You're all invited to mix and mingle over coffee, tea, and food downstairs after. Anyone who wants to join the family after the formal proceedings, you are also invited to join us for a drink at the corner bar, 25 Mount Eden Road. It's an easy 5-minute walk from here. Please note that the venue has kindly asked that no food or drink be brought or consumed in this beautiful great hall. And last, but definitely not least, please try to respect David's wishes to be yourself at all times. The formalities will begin shortly. Apparently they're beginning. Okay. Right. Kia ora e te whānau, o David McDonald, ko Sharu Dalilkin tōku ingoa. Salamat patang, namasaya Sharu Dalilkin. Good evening, friends, family of David McDonald. My name is Sharu, and it's wonderful to have all of you here to celebrate our beautiful friend's life. Haere mai, welcome. We would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge and thank the following. Kahui St. David's for their generous donation of this stunning venue at short notice. The ICU team at Whangarei Hospital and the medical team at Auckland Hospital. David's family, including his dad, Peter, mum, Elsie, sisters Anna, Lizzie, and Orla McDonald, Auntie Marion, Uncle Sean, and their daughter, Aoife Lake, as well as David's cousin, Laura Timms. We'd also like to acknowledge Flavio's mom, Merilde Cotilde Marquez, whom everyone knows as Merilde. All of the care bears and chosen family of David and Flavio, who have been so generous with their time, money, and love in the last few weeks. And of course, all of you present, as well as those live streaming to be here with us from afar. I'll just wait for some people who are coming in. Did you ever meet someone who stormed into your life with happiness on his face and kind words, made scones the first time you met him, advised you on how to do up your garden but actually preferred sitting in it with you, lent you his bathroom when yours was still under construction, offered you his car when yours was stolen but then apparently lost his keys when you accepted his kind offer, cares more about you, about how you are, than who or what you are, likes salmon mousse so much and cucumber so little. And lastly, did you ever meet someone who immediately made you want to be his friend? If so, then you were indeed lucky enough to meet the powerhouse that is David McDonald. Thinking of David, numerous words come to mind: selfless, vivacious, kind, talented, caring, generous to a fault, positive, proud to be himself, lives like life to the fullest, a dreamer, infectious smile, humorous, cheeky, sarcastic, articulate, inclusive, enthusiastic, and above all, a true friend. These are just a few characteristics that David possesses. Which brings me to the tense in which we are choosing to celebrate our dear friend. Te Aumari talks about the living and those who we have lost in the present tense. We also will try to do this as much as possible to celebrate his extraordinary life and his larger-than-life presence. Tonight, although we are all so shocked and torn up by his passing, we have chosen to honor our amazing David's legacy with as much happiness, color, and celebration as we can muster. During the course of this evening, various people will give you insights into many facets of David's journey that led him across the world while touching so many of us. This evening, we will paint a picture of his colorful, joyous life, which spans Ireland, Australia, Aotearoa, New Zealand, and includes his professional work at Stantec. He could have been said to have been a traveling Wilbury at some stages, but after traveling so much, both professionally and personally, he found his home in a person, not a place. The love of his life, the gorgeous Flavio Villani. It is evident to all that meeting Flavio completed him. Personally, I was fortunate to have met David very soon after they did. Flavio invited us to his home to check out his new squeeze. And being the protective friends that we were, my husband and I arrived with suspicion and concern, ready to interrogate this new addition to Flavio's life. And surprise, surprise, it was literally a matter of seconds before we fell in love with David. Hook, line, and sinker. Which makes losing David very difficult to accept. David's love of cooking is renowned, always for other people. Always for other people to share. He gave me the best granola recipes soon after we met. I haven't had the courage to make it recently because it hurts my heart. We all have many small things we will remember over the next years, the next weeks, months, and for many years to come, which will remind us how David influenced us all. And that's as it should be. And part of his legacy. Incidentally, I'm not sharing that recipe with anyone just yet. However, what will be. But to quote David, I'm gonna get on with it and stop pissing about, as I'm sure everyone here is keen to celebrate the beautiful person that David is to all of us. Without further delay, I have the privilege and honor to present my dear friend and David's life partner, Flavio Villani. Being the world-renowned musician that he is, the maestro is going to play Goodnight Bello for us. This is a piece he has composed for David.
I just want to say something very quickly. Goodnight Bello was made, it was very simple, and it was made while we were in lockdown during the 3 months of 2021. when we were separated. That was probably the longest time we've been separated. And yeah, that's it. Thank you for being here. There's no need to clap. I think David would be proud to see you today, the colorful bunch you are. So thank you for participating in his joyful way of being. I hope I not take too many pauses. If I'll need them, excuse me. And if I'll need too much pause, I'll have a friend that will come and support me and continue the reading. How do you summarize 3.5 years of love? I've struggled to sit still and write anything, partly because the act of stopping to write would surely unleash a flood of emotions, and partly because it's challenging to make sense of the journey that led us to this moment. Perhaps it's also because I still hold on to the hope that with a hard enough knock to the head, I might wake up from this foggy dream and find David smiling by my side, reassuring me in his usual way, "Bello, everything is gonna be all right." But here we are, and I'll do my best to share without letting that flood in. David, I met you on the 3rd of September 2020 in Queenstown. Allow me to share the story of our first encounter. COVID had disrupted all my overseas travel plans in 2020, so it made sense to make the most of staying in New Zealand. Inspired by a friend who was going, I decided to join him in Queenstown for Winter Pride. My plan was not only to attend most of the events, but also engage in as much snowboarding as possible. It was my first time snowboarding, the only at the time a couple of years earlier hardly counts, as I spent most of it on my bum praying for my life. At the end of the day one, I spotted this beautiful man at Coronet getting his ski gear organized after the day of skiing. He was with friends, and being me, I just looked, smiled, awkwardly went my way. The next day, on the 3rd of September, it was 1Z day in Cadrona. So everybody was very colorful. Throughout the day, I wondered if the man from the day before would be still there, would be there as well. And to my surprise, there he was, a half-dressed rainbow unicorn named David, approached me, introduced himself in his cutest accent. We exchanged numbers and headed to the pub at the bottom of the mountains. Sitting at different tables, we stole glances at each other. I asked my friends, he's there and I'm sure he's looking at me. What do I do? How do I start a conversation without Grindr or Tinder? Which is both funny and a bit the sad truth of dating in this decade. But David, being David, got up, came to my table once again, and invited me to join him for drinks in town later that evening. I couldn't believe this was actually happening. The night we had great conversations, so we decided to leave the après-ski to have a proper dinner, just the two of us. There, he shared tales of his family, Ireland, his work, his friends. I heard his laugh multiple times, and we continued sharing each other's story all evening. Our first kiss happened on the broad walks by the lake, and to the stress of the friends I went with, I never made it back to my room. And almost never left his side for the next few days we had in Queenstown. I remember how kindly he went down the slopes with me on his skis the day after, even though he was much more advanced than me, recording each other's progress with our phones, enjoying the exhilarating freedom of letting gravity do its job on the snow. I couldn't help but fall in love with this man in the months to come. From Queenstown, we continued to date for a year while living in different cities, Wellington for him and Auckland for me. It's funny how I had promised myself not to date anyone from out of town before meeting David, and how the rule was so quickly broken after seeing him. We practically lived with each other from the start, as we'd stay in each other's homes whenever we were together. In that year, we probably hadn't been apart for more than 3 weeks at a time until the last lockdown in 2021. David, I learned more about the incredible human you are during that year, and it was only natural we'd want to move in together. We both loved to build a home and a community, and the fun now you built in your years in Wellington and we then built in our life together in Auckland are testament to how family was such an important aspect of your life. The support both myself and his family have received in these last weeks are proof of how much you're loved by so many people and how much you have cared for each one of them. I still remember the jungle of plants that you brought into our home when you moved to Auckland, and the excitement you had while nesting our space. When a space was well organized, when we bought something beautiful, and when you'd be given free rein to decorate the house for Christmas with all your gnomes and decorations, you'd have the most beautiful and pure joy. I still have the videos of you showing me all the little details that would make your soul smile so much brighter. In the next few years, our spirits of adventure undoubtedly found their soulmate in each other. Together, we explore many countries, with countless more we had on our bucket list and calendar plans. You used to joke that our ability to travel for 3 months straight in Europe, spending 24/7 together without wanting to strangle each other at the end of it, was the ultimate seal of approval for a long-lasting relationship. I think you were right. In that time we traveled, we enjoyed each other's funny and quirky company, and we shared our past homes with each other, in Italy and Ireland. It was meant to be another seal of approval in a way. The homes we left behind are still a very important part of ourselves. I come from a relatively small family, my parents, one brother, and three first cousins, compact and lovingly tight. Imagine the shock of this Italian meeting David's family in 2022. Mom and dad, three sisters, 2 dozen uncles and aunties, 30 cousins and their partners and their kids. The thought of meeting such an army of people was quite intimidating, especially for someone like me who needs a name repeated at least 3 times before it sticks in my head. But it was all just beautiful, or as you would have said, fab. Similarly, in Italy, everybody thought the world of you, my brother warning me to make sure I'd not easily let you go and never get back without you. You're a wonderful human being, David, for so many people. In these years, I've learned you're a committed man to his work and his friends, a generous soul who'd help a stranger in need, an attentive human being always wanting the best for those around him, an adventurous soul seeking to experience life to its fullest, a kind man, a positive, bubbly soul, a romantic, an incredible singer, a funny dancer. A protective and caring man who wasn't afraid to be vulnerable as well, one of the most beautiful and rare qualities to find in a man. The times I've seen you hold the space for someone that needed advice and give back golden tips, The Times have seen people showing you their homes, their kitchen, or anything that needed to be renovated, and you had the perfect solution for them, although sometimes also the most expensive one. I was in awe every time I'd see you draw down the plan of a house. You'd have just done one quick walkthrough. I was in awe of your ability to talk to anyone and make anyone feel welcome. Even if you had your own insecurities there, you were always the soul of the room, wherever you were and whoever you were with. All our friends still remember the time you quietened a whole house party just with your singing. I'm pretty sure nobody was breathing by the end of it at how beautiful that was. You accompanied me on most of my personal journeys. You were always my fan number one. I don't think you've missed many of my concerts around the country, big or small they may have been. Even my students' concerts, always there cheering on, helping with tickets, distributing programs, serving drinks, canapé, and helping to clean up. Even if you'd just been asked to do only one of those things, you'd always end up doing three more. I must say, you ended up becoming the main caregiver of some of those events. I think anyone who'd want to help in the future will have some very big shoes to try and step in. When my dad fell sick last year, you came all the way to Italy, and on the same day you arrived, jet lag and all, you went to his room and shaved his beard and helped me nurse him. You were with me when he passed away. You were with me so much that that's probably why it's so hard to let you go now. You believed we had all the time in the world to continue getting to know each other, growing old side by side one day. I've had men telling me soppy things before, but with you I believed it. I never doubted you. I never felt so safe and secure with somebody, trusted someone more than you before. And I think I will treasure many of the things that make me who I am now and have you to thank for. There are many small things that are your legacy in me, the way I fold towels, store clothes, make bed, pack suitcase. I didn't used to care for houses, but now I catch myself saying, David would really like this, or the opposite, David would definitely want to change this. The way I'd say now, you're doing great to people. But the biggest legacy is in my heart. David didn't like to explain his emotions much. He was terrible with the phone. The most openly cheesy message I've ever received was when he was drunk, and he ended it with, never bring this message up, please. He apparently talked about me a lot with other people, but he could go for a full day without calling or texting or saying much really to me. Some of his close friends will empathize with the frustration of trying to get some answers from him through a phone. He used to say he'd prefer to have been born when phones didn't exist and just send letters instead. He didn't need the faff. It took me a while to understand it, especially as an Italian, to attach the foam and decorations. But his love didn't need faff or decoration, was simply there. He told me all he wanted was to see me smile, and oh man, he didn't make me smile. He'd be there for me at every step. He didn't need to announce it. He would quietly be proud of me. He didn't need to declare it. I think in this way he taught me what love is. His love was unquestioning. He taught me to listen, to care for others a lot more than a man sitting most of his day behind the piano can ever learn. If I have been able to hold even a little the space for myself and for others in the terrible 12 days in the hospital that followed his last seizure before New Year's, I owe it to him. The capacity to empathize with other upbringings, other points of view, the passion for equality and inclusivity, I owe this to you, Bello. I wanted this eulogy to include more facts and stories, and I went a bit on a tangent. I hope anyhow that this can attest to some of the beauty and love we have shared these years. I would like to think that David and I had a happy life together. We had always each other's best interest at heart. We were each other's biggest fans. We shared beautiful shows and cinemas, board games and drinks, concerts and chats, amazing food and travel, hikes and galleries, sales and drives, flights and trains, family and friends, tears and laughter. We just wanted to savor life together in all ways that a life could be lived, and we knew we'd be safe in each other's embrace. These days made me think love is in the mundane things. It's in laughing at me for sleeping with a pillow in my head. It's in inventing silly words together. It's in a silly giggle. It's in the shared silence. Love doesn't need grand gestures or constructed poems or a pompous declamation. It is simply there. I thank life for showing me this, but I can't thank her for taking him so soon. I would like to leave you with our song. This is dedicated to you, David. This was supposed to be our first dance. It seems it's going to be our last instead. We used to sing this song in our road trips, each taking one of the voices intertwined like us. For some mysterious twist of the fate, I could almost never finish hearing it without tears welling up in my eyes. I wish you the greatest tale ahead, May this and the love of all these people be your soundtrack. Sail on. See you on that horizon. I love you, Bello. Thank you.
No, I don't believe I'm an angel, but troubles push me to fall. Nor that you could have saved me from God or anything at all.
I won't say you can't help it, you're crazy. An excuse I won't let you have. But your mother was calling me lately, says that you're bad. Don't let me stand on my own. Don't let me stand on
I'm so sorry I'm lost in a big way. I'm no demon, I'm no psychopath. But I'm sorry for you that you ever saw me like that.
I'm here whenever you need me, but I've troubles all of my own. And I need you to hold me, I'm fearful of our unknown. Don't let me stand on my own. Don't let me stand on
signs. I'm calling for you and I need to get through, so stay with me just for the night.
Don't let me stand.
Thank you, Flavia. David has touched many people in his work life at Stantec, as well as been a staunch advocate for the rainbow community and inclusivity. He even recruited me. I personally wouldn't have ever considered working for an engineering company, given my previous work life in the arts. But he has always encouraged me, saying, "You're doing great, you're doing great." Ironically, it used to annoy the shit out of me, but it is something now I'd give anything to hear him say one more time. I have David to thank for my career and my new whānau in Stantec. I'd now like to invite Steph, supported by Johan, who are the leading lights in our Stantec family, to say a few words. This will be followed by my Stante Fano, who will sing a waiata, a song titled Whakare Mai.
Kia ora te whānau. Dave started with Stantec in the water team of our Wellington office in May 2019. I met Dave a week or two beforehand when I interviewed him. And hands down, he was and still is the fastest talking Irishman I have ever met. This wasn't like any usual interview. Dave didn't put on any facade. There wasn't any spinning of any cliche phrases or jargon. And within 5 minutes, I knew Dave was an obvious hire. I also knew he was going to be an absolute gem in our team. But what I didn't know at that time was he was actually going to be a diamond in our team. Aside from making us laugh in his interview, Dave caught me a little off guard. He told me he was gay, and my initial response was to congratulate him. I asked him why he felt he had to tell me that. He said he'd had a problem in previous employments due to discrimination, and he asked me if Stantec would have any issues with that. I felt embarrassed for the world that we live in that Dave felt he had to ask me that question in his interview. Some 7 years ago, Stantec initiated our inclusion and diversity moment. I told Dave this to answer his question. It was then I saw for the very first time his smile, the Dave smile, the beaming, twinkly-eyed, soul-warming smile followed by a beautiful, hearty laugh. That smile and laugh combination we all know so well and hold so dear. Without hesitation upon joining us, Dave was the inaugural Reach at Stantec New Zealand leader. Reach at Stantec was formed to provide a collective group that promotes and supports all forms of diversity and works to ensure that we are an authentically inclusive workplace. That wasn't quite enough for Dave. He also participated in the Asia Pacific Inclusion and Diversity Council, where he drove change and he challenged our senior and executive leadership across the globe to do better where we could. Dave was also single-handedly responsible for Stantec New Zealand achieving the Rainbow Tick accreditation in 2021, which was a massive achievement, one that we are personally very proud of, as was Dave. We couldn't have completed this without Dave's passion for putting people first and doing what is right. Dave was heading off to Winter Pride. Dave made the mistake of using his company credit card to acquire an app on his phone. When pointed out to him, he said that maybe Stantec had made one of the greatest investments of all time. Turns out he didn't need it after all, so perhaps not a great investment, but it did enable us to award him the Spoon of the Year at the Social Club Christmas party. In speaking with both Flavio and Bro over the last few days, it has been incredibly humbling to hear how much Dave loves Stantec and the team that he worked with every day. We want to assure you all now that Dave's love for us is completely mutual. What I also want you to know is that as much as Dave shared stories of Stantec with all of you, he also shared so much of all of you with us, especially his love for Flavio and his pride when it came to Bo's achievements. There are so many things I'm going to miss more than I can count, but I'm always going to hold dear the project review meetings I did with Dave via Teams calls when he worked from home some days. Dave would ask me if I could hear Flavio playing the piano in the background, and when I said I couldn't, he'd amend his setup so I could listen in and share in Dave's love, pride, and awe or whatever Flavio may have been creating that day. That was one of the amazing things about Dave. There didn't seem to be a work and home life separation. No matter how you knew Dave, you knew all of Dave. He shared everything with you, and he let you know who and what he loved. I want you to know that Dave was no standard project manager in our engineering firm. Not only was Dave a senior project manager, but he was a team leader of a dozen project managers in Upper North Island. It didn't matter if you were green and starting out in our business, or a wiser, grumpier, graying senior in the team. Everyone that Davey either led directly or led on a project absolutely adored working with him. Dave's mantra was all about the people working on the project. He got their back, he sensed their concerns, and he problem solved over coffee or margaritas or both at the same time and developed a seamless relationship with his clients. Now, the formalities and paperwork were often of little interest to Dave, and sometimes they never came to fruition. But it didn't stop him turning his hand to any type of project, whether it was modeling, consenting, treatment plants or poo plants, as he called them, pump stations or pipe networks. Nothing was ever too big or too problematic for our Dave. Getting back to one of Dave's strengths, Dave and I once interviewed a gentleman who, despite Dave introducing me as his boss, which I hated, the candidate refused to face me, to talk to me directly, or to answer my questions. He would only respond to Dave. We had got about 4 questions deep out of 10, and Dave abruptly ended the interview. He thanked the gentleman for his time and escorted him from the office. He came back into the meeting room so flustered and red, walking faster than usual. He opened his mouth with a very strong expletive. I'll let you imagine him saying the expletive of your choice. He said to me, "What a horrible human being. That man will never work for Stantec. He is a rude little man." I wasn't Dave's leader that day. He was mine. He protected me, stood up for me, and for our office. As a team, we will honor Dave in all that we do, and as a team, in every project we deliver, and in the way we look after each other. Nothing will ever replace the vibrancy that Dave gifted our office, and we wouldn't wish it to. What has changed forever is that instead of relying on Dave to be that person in our lives, every single one of us will take the treasures, the love, the support, the kind words, and the genuine presence that Dave gave us, and we will pay it forward. We are all and we'll continue to be better people for ourselves, our families, and our communities by leading, caring, and sharing how Dave always has. And as he always ended every single one of my chats with him, "You're doing great. Aroha nui."
Thank you, Stefan. Johan? And thanks, Stantec. We are honored that members of David's family are here from Wellington and also all the way from Ireland. Crucially, they have been by David and Flavio's side during these difficult weeks. David's sister, Orla, will now share some memories and thoughts that have been written by her sister, Anna.
Oh, Lord. Yeah, my sisters at home wrote this, so yeah, best of luck to me. David is the cherished second-born child of Elsie and Peter MacDonald. He came 2 years after his older sister, Anna, and then followed two more sisters, Lizzie and Orla. That's me. David's home place is situated in the rural Irish countryside in County Laois, and he grew up surrounded by green fields full of cattle and wild rabbits, only steps away from a stone bridge over the Onis River. David's father, a farmer, kept cows nearby, and the siblings, including David, often knew the cows by name and referred to them as pets. David was distraught 1 year to find out that his pet cow, Towser, was in the family's chest freezer, and he refused to eat any meat except sausages for a whole year. David's childhood included a large family of aunts, uncles, and cousins who lived nearby, and we always remained close as we grew up together. Even as a child, David loved to sketch, design houses, on paper first and then for hours on the family PC. He also enjoyed playing with Lego and building elaborate miniature homes, which he displayed lovingly in front of and in the way of the sitting room fireplace, which could not be moved under any circumstances. Days would pass by and David's Lego houses still would not be touched, and they would be left in front of the fireplace where he left them. David attended the local primary and secondary schools in Mount Mellick, but he really found his stride when he headed off to Carlow IT College, where he studied architectural engineering. At this stage in his life, David was a big, fun-loving, long-haired rocker dude who loved to drive his car at speed, his first car, a Volkswagen Golf, to and from college. He'd fill the car boot with Mammy's potatoes and bring them back to college to feed his housemates. Fueled on spud dinners, often made by Dave, they would party every night together. Throughout his college years, David worked weekends and holidays in the community nursing home, joining his mother, two sisters, and a large gang of local staff. He did weeks of day shifts, weeks of night shifts too, and he was a natural-born carer. The long and hard-working days were offset by fun nights of partying with his workmates. While in night shift, David would often fall asleep on the way home, most famously in the hospital gateway. In his spare time, he loved to be with family and friends. Again, he would drive speedily between locations, now in his much faster, bright purple Honda Accord. He enjoyed house renovation programs on TV, particularly grand designs, always critiquing the ideas of the architects, and he'd say, should have done it this way. We can picture David in heaven now, just like Kevin MacLeod of Grand Designs, redesigning his new home. Come on, we'll talk about it over a glass of wine and a grazing table, he'd say. When David finally found himself and discovered his love of travel, he then remodeled his look. He lost the ponytail, and a new and reinvented David appeared. He once cared for an elderly patient in the hospital who insisted on being freshly shaved, washed, and dressed daily in a full suit. This old man's motto was, if you're going bad, dress well. And David definitely took pride in his appearance and loved to style himself. Eventually, Much to our heartbreak, this all led him to move to Australia and then New Zealand, where he found his home away from home. David's wonderful, though too short, life story was exciting and fun-filled and continued with all of you here in New Zealand. But he never lost touch with home and remains the golden boy of Derry Davy. He's adored by family and friends, including his niece and two nephews, who were born when he was away. He brought a smile and happiness to people's lives. You could not leave David's company in a bad mood, especially after a long conversation or a big bear hug. This never changed in his phone calls and visits to Ireland. David finally met his great love, known to us as Flavers. Many more amazing friends, and found his dream job too in Stantec. David was so proud of his personal achievements, including most recently becoming manager over the North Island. These last few years were the happiest that he had ever been. David lived life to the fullest. "We're here for a good time, not for a long time," was another saying he liked to quote. He certainly knew how to work hard for a living, but he also knew how to spend and enjoy the money that he earned by living his authentic life every day. David was truly so happy and so, so loved by so many. Our beautiful, beloved brother, may he rest in peace.
Thank you, Anna and Orla. Edward Lawrenson will now sing Danny Boy, which is a traditional Irish folk song.
Dead as dead I find the place where I am lying and kneel and say an Ave there for me. And I shall feel how soft you tread above me, and then my
Thank you, Edward. My heart goes out to David's cousin, Laura, who I know is gutted not to be here today. After tireless days and nights by David's side in Whangarei, Laura had to fly back home to Margaret River, Perth, Australia. One of our care bears, Hugh, will now read Laura's words to talk about his time in Australia.
You could say that Dave and I were destined to be close. We were born just 2 months apart and grew up in a big, close family network, the family mafia, just minutes away from each other. They say you can't choose your family, but I was lucky enough to have Dave as both a cousin and a friend. Dave's life changed forever when he decided to come to Australia and meet me on my working holiday visa. He sold his car, tried his best to save, and arrived in Perth in January 2012 with very little money. Shortly after he arrived, he told me something that changed everything. He told me he was gay. And when I didn't seem surprised, he wondered why. I replied, "Well, I always thought that you were gay." Dave followed with, "Well, it's a pity you didn't tell me." From that day on, Dave would refer to this as the gay. And as time went on, he learned to accept and embrace being gay with the help of the love and acceptance of his family and friends. We had our ups and downs, but we have so many memories to show for it. From Perth, we went to Margaret River, where we picked grapes for our second year visa, or should I say, I picked grapes. He just complained a lot and pretended to work. We found a place to live while we were there and picked up some great stragglers along the way. We also bought a car together, which Dave named Maggie Mae Barina. Our cousin Beryl from Perth would come to visit us, and she got great joy out of moments such as Dave sitting in a cafe, hungover, drinking from a china cup with his pinky finger sticking out. I have fond memories of us walking down the main street, drinking from a goon sack, while looking for a party in a quiet town. We quickly became wine snobs from a few wine tasting outings and ditched the goon sacks. We had our sayings, and one of them from this time was, "Jog on." When the grape picking season finished, we decided to head to Broome in Maggie May and did the big drive up the west coast. We ended up in a town called Exmouth, where we met some friends and decided to stay. We never actually made it up to Broome, and Exmouth was where I left Dave to go back to Ireland for a while. By that stage, Dave had built some friendships and the confidence to go ahead on his own. I think what Dave loved most about traveling was meeting people and making friendships that he would have at any given time. Sorry, I'll just rewind there a little bit. I think that what Dave loved most about traveling was meeting people and making connections. I tend to be a bit more introverted, and I would laugh at the large number of friends that he would have at any given time. He was always the life and soul of the party and often was heard solving the problems of the world after a Carlton dry or 10. At that stage, Maggie May Barina hadn't received much care, and I remember asking Dave a few times to check on the oil since he drove it mostly for work. After we had both left, a fellow co-owner went to collect the car and was informed that Maggie May went pop. I can only assume that that oil check never happened. While back in Ireland, I unfortunately couldn't get my second year visa for Australia, and I was devastated. So instead of Dave heading back to Australia as planned, he came with me to New Zealand without a penny between us. We arrived at Marion, Sean, and Aoife's house, and eventually found our place after some interesting accommodation situations. I think we were there for around a month, and I told Dave that it was time he made some gay friends. On a night out, I made some friends for him named Andy and Elliot, and the rest is history. Not long after that, he met Derv, who ended up replacing me as Mammy when I moved back to Australia in 2014. From there, Dave built such a great community in Wellington and often told me stories about various people as if I should know who he was talking about. He had his ups and downs in Wellington and at times flitted between wanting to buy a house there and wanting to leave until he's got his job at Stantec and then met Flavio, which brought about another change in his life. Dave, we have had such crazy fun times together. As I looked through messages from the last 12 years, I couldn't believe how much we had gone through together and how much we have shared since we first arrived in Australia. I still can't believe that COVID has meant that I haven't been able to see you for so long, and I can only cherish the memories that we had. As I said to you in one of our last conversations, you will always be my best friend, even if I haven't seen you in ages. Through all this, I am so glad to have met Flavio and can see why you are so happy together. I am heartbroken and can't quite get my head around the fact that I won't get to hear your infectious giggle again, but I will carry our happy times together in my heart always.
Thank you, Laura and Hugh. Edward will now sing Elton John's Your Song with Maria Moore on piano. It's a perfect David ballad, as Elton John was a favorite.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I'm not one of those who can easily hide. I don't got much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I were a sculptor, but then again, no, or a man who makes potions and a traveling show. I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, and this one's for you. And you can tell everybody that this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is now you're in the world. I sat on the roof and I kicked off the moss. Well, a few of these verses, well, they got me quite cross. But the sun's been kind while I wrote this song. It's for people like you that keep it turned on. So excuse me for getting, but these things I do, you see, I've forgotten if they're green or they're blue. But one thing is, I really love you, and yours are the sweetest eyes I've ever seen. And you can tell everybody that this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is now you're in the world. I hope you don't mind, don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is now you're in the world. Thank
you, Edward and Maria. I'm going to read what I'm going to read, but I think Andy's coming. Sorry, Elliot's coming up. So, sorry. Sorry, Dad. Andy and Elliot are two of David's best friends who traveled all the way from the metropolis of Te Whanganui Atara, aka Wellington, to be at David's side up in Whangarei. They are also here, well, one of them is going to come up to share some of their memories.
All right. Can I move this? Yeah. All right. Hi, everyone. For those who don't know me, I'm Elliot. I may tap out at some point during this, but we'll see. So me and Andy are two of David's best friends for about 12 years of living in Wellington. After David was thrown into our lives by his cousin Laura, as you've heard. David had recently come out to her and she decided that he needed gay friends, as you've heard. And spotting us in a bar on St. Patrick's Day, her gaydar pinged and our lives changed forever. This is what David told us, at least. We were too drunk to remember and didn't remember how we met or who Laura was. It's funny how someone can't remember a plan he made 20 minutes ago, but can remember a person by name who he's met once while drunk 3 months ago. But that's just who David was. For years, we flitted in and out of each other's lives, as people do in their partying 20s, always excited to see each other and always happy to hang out. But in the year of 2017, David moved into our flat in Newtown, and thus began the real cementing of our already solid friendship. We lived together for around 4 years after that, and we're a family. We ate together, we watched together. Andy and David would go for drives. I could never hear over the music in the back seat, and drives were never really my thing. People came and people went, but the three of us were always there. We saw each other through thick and thin, through our hardest times and moments of weakness. David transformed the garden of this house and turned the house into a garden. And I think if you know David, you know what I mean. He made it into his home, talked about all the things he'd change about the house and sketch the designs. We did lockdown together, and David worked while the two of us lost our minds, and David lost his mind at the two of us for sitting around all day while he worked. We would spend time in the garden. We got dressed up in formal attire for Friday and gorged ourselves on whatever weird desserts David had concocted. He would sing constantly and whistle and bop, and asking him to stop was pointless because he'd only sing louder. And no matter how much we grew to hate it at the time, we wouldn't change a thing. You wouldn't change a single thing about him, except maybe his communication skills and his memory. But again, that's just David. You could never stay mad at the bastard either, because he was such a bubbling pile of joy. So any house bickers were always over as fast as they began. Lockdown done, David went to Gay Ski Week, as we've heard, in Queenstown, and we heard all about his amazing time, and I think you know where this is leading. It's leading to the only thing that would have taken him from Wellington, and that's love. David met Flavio, and from our home we saw him grow increasingly infatuated. Who am I kidding? He was from the moment he came back. And he would have Flavio visit and be in his little tizzies about it every time. One of my favorite memories of these days was when the two of them had a Valentine's Day together in Wellington. So David's saddo single flatmates ran off and set up a picnic for the two of them so that David could surprise Flavio with it. And we hid and watched as they arrived. We could see what was happening, and we couldn't have been any happier for the two of them, and inevitably we said goodbye to our household, but never our friendship. 12 years of the most low-maintenance friendships, distance, communication, and time could never touch what we had and never will. I'll leave you to be filled in with a little bit more of his time now, but before I go, I'm going to part you with a little word from Andy. With Andy being a Roma gypsy, there is a belief, and that is that death has twin siblings called happiness and sadness. Once the person is taken by death in a warm embrace, his twin siblings come and visit the family and friends, and they don't leave until they can make peace with them. Farewell, David, our brother. Merci buckets for the time you gave us. And if you don't know, that's French for thank you very much.
Thanks, Elliot and Andy. Maria Moe will sing How Far I'll Go from Moana, accompanied by Claire Cohen on cello. This was another of David's favorite faves and speaks to the traveling spirit.
Been staring at the edge of the water long as I can remember, never really knowing why. I wish I could be the perfect daughter, but I come back to the water no matter how hard I try. Every turn I take, every trail I check, every path I make, every road leads back to the place I know, where I cannot go, where I long to be. See the light where the sky meets the sea, it calls me, and no one knows how far it goes. If the wind in my sails on the sea stays behind me, one day I'll know. If I go, there's just no telling how far I'll go. I know everybody on this island seems so happy on this island. Everything is by design. I know everybody on this island has a role on this island. Maybe I can row with mine. I can lead with pride, I can make us strong. I'll be satisfied if I play along, but the voice inside sings a different song. What is wrong with me? See the light as it shines on the sea, it's blinding, but no one knows how deep it goes. And it seems like it's calling out to me, so come find me and let me know what's beyond that line. Will I cross that line? See the light where the sky meets the sea, it calls me, and no one knows how far it goes. If the wind in my sails on the sea stays behind me, one day I'll know how far I'll go.
Thanks, Maria. Thanks, Claire. The next speakers, Bro and Priscilla, have been the rocks of Gayland, or as Flavio would say, Gaysland. Both have lived with Flavio over the years And bro, most recently, is the guiding star completing the threesome that is David, Flavio, and bro. Both were members of the group supporting, the Care Bears supporting Flavio, David, the Irish family, and the wider community during these last few weeks. Take it away.
Man. Whew, okay. You ready?
Yes.
Okay. Tēnā koutou katoa, hei whakamiharo, ke kone koutou katoa ki te whakanui a David. Ko bro toku ingoa. My name's Bro, and it's absolutely wonderful that you're all here to celebrate. We knew there would be a lot of you, and there are. I call David one of my dearest friends and a brother. We kind of gave each other that title most recently when I came back from the United States, and David was so excited to hear that I thought of him as a brother and Flavio as a brother, and both of you were like, yay, we think the same. The other person who holds these titles, like I just said, is Flavio. David is and will always be a light of my life. While David didn't speak today on Māori, one of the things that delights me most about him is his deep empathy and interest in all people. We've heard a lot about this tonight, so I'm gonna be repeating some of the same themes. No matter who you are or where you come from, he has an insatiable desire to make all people feel seen and heard. He would often ask me how to pronounce reo Māori. Mine's not perfect, but he was always excited to learn more. And he would always want to understand its meaning. He'd excitedly come to any and every event celebrating people of every identity and culture, which is one of my favorite things to do, so he was often by my side. And as those from Stantec know, we've heard a lot about Stantec, he's so deeply proud to have worked to make that rainbow tick happen at Stantec. If we don't know what that means exactly, it certifies and accepts, or it certifies that it accepts and values people embracing its diversity of sexual and gender identities. David, Flavio, and I live together, as was just described, in a home fondly called Gayland, and I've always thought it was quite sweet that Flavio insists on calling it Gaysland, and I insist on calling it Gayland, and both are perfect. That house is the center of home and heart. This isn't simply because it's a structure with walls and beds, although we have plenty of those. It's a place where David would often say, the more, the merrier, and never think twice about filling it with even more people, which goes the same for Flavio. Anyone is always welcome and will continue to always be welcome in our home. Our house is often so full that we had to create a booking calendar to make sure that there are always beds and plates for guests. While I'm the sister that quietly retreats to her room when I've had enough of all the people, David and Flavio would be up into the night making sure that everyone has a plate or a drink in their hands. David would have the music loud, keeping everyone laughing and vibing. And if Flavio can pull it off, he'll make sure there are heart circles with everyone sharing their deepest feelings. And often, we'd all be sitting around the piano singing ballads with Claire playing along. Claire was the one on cello earlier. For those sharing a life with David here in Auckland, of which there are many, obviously, most would pass through the Gayland back doorstep. And even if you weren't there to see David, he'd greet you with a giant smile of delight, so excited that you'd arrived. A friend of mine who'd only met David briefly summed this up perfectly. I came over to the house to see Bro and brought some snacks. As I was sitting at the kitchen top complaining that I might have a mouth ulcer, David came out of his room, calmly got all of the kai out of the bag, of which she'd brought some little bits to make a platter. David meticulously arranged the platter, adding his own additional nuts and yummies. He then went into his room, came out with a strip of pills, and said in his charming accent, "Here you go. Take these twice a day for a few days and you should be just fine. Don't worry, honey, it happens to the best of us." He then finished the platter and set it up for Bro and I outside and left back into his room. I remember thinking, no, no, stay, fairy god uncle. I want to talk to you. One of the most beautiful things to witness was Dave's absolute adoration of Flavia. While Flavia would fly through the house in a fluster on his way to a concert, dinner, or some other social event, David would trail behind him, helping him find his keys or his wallet, saying with a smile, "Oh, Bello." And there would be no event without a fashion show first. David and Flavia would come out of their rooms in an outfit, and I'd suggest more power-clashing patterns for Flavia and sleek color matching for David. Getting dressed is just as important of an event as the event itself. Today, I am wearing heels for David. I would never do this by choice. And out in the world, you'll all know how these two painted the city rainbow. David and Flavia were at every major pride event or hanging out with the proud queers crew or the gays. David loved Flavia's excitement for his red leather hot pants and bought him a pair of sneakers to match for Christmas. And if David wasn't painting the city rainbow, he was with his Stantec colleagues having a laugh in and out of work, telling stories and delighting in everyone else's. He absolutely adores his work. While David would openly admit it drove him mad and he worked too hard, he knew how loved and supported he is by his colleagues. A special shout out to Steph, who was the center of most of our nightly debriefs. David has too many friends to name. That's a sign of his character and how he lit up the world. But there's a special group that really showed up for him in his last few days. Well, the last couple weeks, really. And Priscilla's gonna talk about them and his family. And as a dear friend said with perfectly fitting words, "Owe, tangiana te na ko, moi mai ra, David. Oh, my heart is crying. Sleep well, David."
Sorry, bear with. Okay. As many of you know, David strongly believed in the power of love. He believed in loving people for who they are, and he believed up in showing up for people. And speaking of showing up, the last 2 weeks, I experienced the most beautiful showing up I have seen in my whole life. When we found out about David and how he was up in Whangarei Hospital, people just dropped what they were doing and they headed straight there because they wanted to be there for David and they wanted to be there for you, Flavio. I witnessed an extraordinary support network that showed up and watching everyone coming together, uniting with no ego, no let's do it this way, or it was just about how can we be with you, Flavio, and how can we be with your family, David's family, and how do we make this easier? I want to thank everyone. There's hundreds of you that have shown up for David, and you gave, so like, big or small, it was just incredible. And I want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts, the ones that who have been close to David. Thank you so much for doing everything. All of this happened in 4 days, and that's because of you and for everyone being here. I wish to express my deep appreciation for David's family. Sorry, it's really a little writing. Thank you for standing with Flavio, demonstrating unity, and serving as the voice for David. Your openness in allowing others, people who you never knew, to come together and be in a space up in Whangarei Hospital during such a challenging time was such a gift to all of us. Thank you so much. You were all just incredibly amazing. And I'm thankful that I could have met you all, and it was an honor to walk with you and to care for you and feed you and do anything that was possible to make just the time up there a bit easier. Even though sometimes I couldn't understand your accents, I would nod, smile, and then I would feed you. So many people love David, including me, and I want you to know that we will keep celebrating David and his memory, and we will continuously talk about him, and we won't forget him. He has touched so many people's lives. And if any of you come back to Auckland, please let us know, and let's go have a pint together. Okay. Flavio. My beautiful one. You are like a brother to me, one of the most beautiful souls I know. And I want to take this moment to honor you. Honor how you showed up and loved David during this time is one of the most beautiful things I have witnessed. You have been an example of love in every way. How you embraced and loved David and those around you has been incredible. You set the standard for how everyone was going to treat David up in the hospital. You were his voice, and you ensured David's wishes were honored. I witnessed how you interacted with everyone from the doctors, the nurses, to David's family and friends with so much kindness, patience, and love. Despite enduring your own pain, you constantly embodied the essence of love right until the very end. Thank you, Flavio, for loving David and being such a beautiful human. I want you to know you are also so loved. And we want you to know you're not alone in this. David, you don't have to worry about Flavio. We've got him. And we are going to walk with him. We're going to cry with him. We're going to stand with him, and we're going to hold him, and we're going to love him through this time. So, in David's memory, may we be more like him. May we love fiercely, show up for people, eat good food, and have a fucking fun time doing it. We love you, David, and we love you, Flavio. You got this.
Thank you, Bro. Thank you, Priscilla, for those heartfelt words. I'd like to take this opportunity to reiterate the family's thanks to everyone for their boundless support, kind messages, copious amounts of food, financial contributions, and accommodation, to name but a few. And if the IT gods are being kind to us, we will now share videos, images, and sounds of David. This will be followed by a snippet from This Is Me from The Greatest Showman before we throw streamers on our way downstairs to continue celebrating with Kai and to take a moment to write a few words for David's memory board. Thank you, everyone. Ngā mihi nui. We love you, David.
We're on with your list. Merry Christmas. Wow, what's the name of dancing? That's a great dancing. Wind swipers. Wine sweepers.
Wind swipers.
Yeah, that's it.
We'll do it like Cribs, and it'll just be like, come on into my home. Can we do that?
Yeah, we'll do it. All right.
We need to all have matching sweaters like you have right now.
Orange mustard sweater. Everyone's recording me now. You're doing great. You're doing great.
Give him your paw, little Winston.
Oh, the paw was a chasing.
It takes somebody's not our soul. I cannot believe you got me a Deborah egg. It's a Deborah egg. You can hold me honestly. This should not be as cool a present as it is. Oh, it's so cool.
Look how you are.
And I just think, I really like Invercargill first of all, but also I think you could do quite well with a little concert down there. A lot of rich white people down here, so like loads of people that'll come to your concert. I think you should have a concert in Invercargill.
Take me fast or take me slow. I don't know, we don't know. Take me home.
Yeah, you're gonna have the most amazing life. It's gonna be real cool. I can see it all laid out in front of you. Megan's gonna keep bringing home little dogs. Morgan's gonna be like, oh fuck, here's another dog. It's gonna be amazing. You're gonna love it. I just hope you have, yeah, like the best life and you're happy and healthy and all the rest of the shit that doesn't really matter. Forget and don't worry about that and just have a great time and enjoy it and laugh and love and yeah, love you guys.
Right. I can't actually remember what we're doing. Are we going to do the This Is Me? Yeah, yeah. From The Greatest Showman, and then it'll play over the speakers. And we'll get Bro to come and direct the crowd with the streamers that I think you've been briefed about. And that's me, I'm out.
This is me.
This is